Hey, what's up, beautiful people? I'm Jay. I'm your MC, repping that Big Dad Energy, introducing my boy, my man, Jamie. Let's go.
Every day is Father's Day when they call you Big Papa. Put that mortgage on top like a real showstopper.
Okay.
When it's time for your allowance, I'm the one to make it rain. When your report card's bad, I'm the one to bring the pain.
Okay.
I am a daddy. I have been anointed. I never get mad, I just get disappointed. Who is your daddy? There's no one else it could be. Scream and clean up your room, Big Dad Energy. I do those dad things like wear wedding rings. I take out the trash, eat chicken wings. Show you how to ride a bike, make love to your mom. Step on a Lego and scream, damn it, come on. I am a daddy. I have been appointed. Look what I found in your room. Tell me who's this joint is. Who is your daddy? There's no one else it could be. Scream and do your homework, Big Dad Energy.
Let's go, y'all. Let's go. Let's go.
I'll man the grill.
He'll man the grill.
Like you know I will.
Like you know he will.
Flip the meat on time.
Flip the meat on time.
And take my heart pill. I drink Bush Light.
He drink it up.
I like to play catch.
Okay.
I show you how to throw a ball.
And what else?
Teach the dog to fetch.
Oh.
Out in the garage, I'm popping hoods. You know at Christmas time, I got the goods. I'm secretly Santa Claus.
Whoa.
Toys beneath the tree. You think they're from the North Pole? Nah, son, they're from me.
For real?
I am a daddy. I sit upon the throne.
Yeah,
I'm the one in charge until your mom gets home. Butterfly kisses. You're still a kid to me. Even when I take a nap.
Big Dad Energy.
Everywhere I go.
Big Dad Energy.
Let's go, y'all. I got a lawn to mow.
Big Dad Energy.
Yeah. Say it like you know.
Big Dad Energy.
Okay. How would you describe this flow?
Big Dad Energy.
Bam. Give it up for my next door neighbor, Jared. Thank you guys for being here. You guys feeling good tonight? Can I be honest with you? I'm not a dad. I have zero children. Not even any stepchildren. But you know, here's the deal. I know I give off a major dad vibe, right? Like, I know what this looks like. I'm 42 years old, and I don't know how I got here. Well, I mean, I know how I got here. I drove a Honda. When you hit your 40s, time kind of stops. You look back and realize I'm as far away from my 20s now as I was when I was a baby. How did that happen? I used to spend my weekends getting drunk with punk rockers. The wildest thing I did last weekend was have a second slice of Betty Crocker's. I used to be on the hunt for drugs and casual sex. Now I'm more into hugs and mildly seasoned Tex-Mex. I used to have my nipples pierced. Yeah, that is a fact. Now I suffer from chronic pain that's fierce. Mostly in my lower back. I used to party, you guys. I once saw the Backstreet Boys live. There's more to it. At Disney World, while on LSD. Anybody else? Just me? It was 1998, and I was in the 12th grade that year. And Disney World used to host an annual event, they might still do this, called Grad Night, where they would keep the theme park open overnight for high school seniors, like an all-night field trip. Senior classes all over the state of Florida would load up on the charter buses, drive up to Orlando, and just like hang out at Disney all night long. And I remember before our bus left the parking lot, the police show up. And they've got these drug-sniffing dogs. We all had to let them smell our backpacks to make sure nobody was sneaking any marijuana or alcohol into Disney. But here's the thing. LSD doesn't have a scent. Yeah, the dogs can't detect it. It was the only drug that anybody was able to sneak in. And one kid brought a bunch of it. He was selling it on the bus. And my friend Orion McMichael, he plops down on the seat next to mine and goes, hey, Jamie, you want to do some acid tonight? I thought about it for a minute. It's like, yeah, I think I do. My answer surprised even myself. I had never done any acid up to that point. I didn't even know how to get acid if I wanted to. Do you just ask? Pardon me, do you happen to have any acid? No? In that case, just $10 on pump 5. I grew up during the war on drugs, you know, when Just Say No propaganda permeated pop culture. We were inundated with celebrity PSAs and commercials with phrases like, I learned it from watching you, all right? There was this after-school special where a kid gets high on PCP. He believes he has the ability to fly and leaps off the roof of a building to his death. Personally, I found the content to be a little heavy for 3 p.m. We have McGruff the Crime Dog and the most popular free t-shirt campaign of them all, the DARE program. Where a police officer would come into your classroom and dare you to not do drugs. Nothing will make you want to do drugs more. Clearly the program didn't work. I mean, the very first time I was offered acid, immediately I was like, yes, I would like some of that, please. But I figured if I was going to try a mind-altering substance, what better time than when I was heading to a place called the Magic Kingdom, where the evening entertainment would include rides with names like Space Mountain, the Tower of Terror. One of the rides was just a hall filled with former U.S. presidents in hologram form. Plus, I get to spin around in one of those giant teacups. Yeah, dude, give me them drugs. Disney knew they needed to ramp up the entertainment factor for grad night. We weren't just little kids. We were high school seniors on the precipice of college. You know, the rides weren't enough. We needed more. We needed live music. And Disney delivered. This was 1998. They brought in some of the biggest musical acts of the era. They brought in the Backstreet Boys to headline. Now, this was also during that year and a half when ska was popular. Yeah, they brought in Real Big Fish. It was a skanking good time. Parents and teachers, they try to scare you by telling you drugs are a slippery slope. You do drugs once, the next thing you know, you're selling your body on the street for your next fix. The problem is they lump all the drugs into the same category. LSD's not heroin, it's not crack. Nobody's selling their body for acid. Nobody's out there going, I'll let you do anything you want to me. Whatever it takes to see them trails, man. Like, the worst thing that happened was when the Backstreet Boys took the stage, they sounded like the Backstreet Boys. But the acid had kicked in pretty hard at that point. They did not look like the Backstreet Boys. They looked like giant dancing lizard people. And they got to that part of the song where they're like, am I sexual? And I was like, God, I hope not. Flash forward to my 40s. Now I take antacid at Disney World. So my wife and I, we didn't meet each other until we were almost 40. And when you meet someone at that age and things start to get serious, you have to ask yourselves a question. Are we having kids or what? Because time is ticking. That's one of nature's cruelest pranks, the biological clock. Ladies, you got a limited number of eggs. Every month that number is going to reduce. And when they're gone, sister. Fellas, on the other hand, you're going to be producing forever. You can be an old man and still make a baby. Gross. I think that's nature's way of saying that women are more responsible than men. If men had a limited number of sperm, the human race would be extinct. I know I'd have run out before I turned 16. I didn't lose my virginity till I was 18. So we're dating, and things are getting serious, and we have to make a decision. Are we having children? Because if we are, we got to get started right away, which I'm pretty sure is going to get us kicked out of this Outback Steakhouse. I know they say no rules, but I don't think that's what they mean. The other option is we could look into freezing some of our eggs. I don't know if you've ever priced this out. It is expensive to freeze a woman's eggs. It costs like $10,000. Plus, there's an annual storage fee. You can't just keep them in your home freezer next to the microwave burritos. And I don't think I'd want to. I'd hate to have to explain to my future child, the reason you stutter and you're bad at math is because you got freezer burn. The thing about approaching middle ages, there's all this buildup. a lifetime of experiences, four decades of lessons that you've learned and knowledge that you've amassed. And you want to pass that on. You don't want that information to go to waste. And if I had children, I could pass that information on to them. But I don't have kids. And I've got all this, well, this big dad energy flowing through me. And I need to find a way to burn it off. So I'm doing what I can. One thing that I found that helps is I like to go out and just, you know, find a busy street corner. Lots of people walking around. And as people pass by, I don't catcall. That would be rude and inappropriate. What I do is I yell out dad things to them. Like, hey, measure twice, cut once. Sometimes if I'm in a hurry, I like to rattle off several right in a row. Righty tighty, lefty loosey, I pay my taxes. They don't make them like they used to. My favorite is when I see somebody approaching from a distance that clearly does not want to engage. And you can always tell, they pick up the pace, they start walking faster, they look down at the sidewalk, refuse to make eye contact. When I see somebody like that, I like to wait until they walk by me. And as they do, I like to say just loud enough so that only they can hear it, I'm proud of you. Because they look like they need a hug. And telling somebody you're proud of them, that's like giving them a hug with your words. It feels good. I can't get enough of it. I didn't get enough of it as a kid. I think the generation before mine was like afraid of emotion. Dads were like sports coaches. They worried that too much praise would make you complacent. You'd stop trying hard. But praise just fires me up. It makes me feel capable. And if the pandemic like taught me anything, it's we shouldn't hold back our praise. If we don't say it now, it could be too late. So I'm going to say it to some of you right now. You know you need it. And X gon' give it to you. Let's see who we got here. What's your name? That's right. Amir? Amir, you've got a great mustache. I like that. At what point in your life did you decide, I'm a mustache man?
Day one.
Day one. That had to be the most confusing birth. Well, it appears you've had a Gomez Adams. But I like that, Amir. I like that you knew from the beginning who you were, and you're not ashamed to still be a mustache man. The mustache legit looks great. I'm proud of you. Hey, what's your name?
I'm Cindy.
Cindy. Cindy, I like that name. That was Yogi Bear's significant other. Did you know that? Oh, I do topical humor mostly. Cindy, are you by yourself or are you with friends?
I'm with friends.
You're with friends. Are both of those friends next to you? Who are your friends? Jamie and Holly? You had to think about it for a minute, so they're not real good friends. So how do you guys know each other? You're all writers. That makes sense, because you were writing the response in your head, doing some editing. I like that. I like that you guys all came out together. I did a little bit of writing. This part, clearly not. But I love that you're friends that get out and you go out together and you support the arts. That's incredible. Cindy, I'm proud of you. We have got to talk about this necklace. What is your name? You do know that you're wearing a necklace. You looked around. Who could it be? Maybe I'm a trendsetter. Other people are wearing them too now. You changed it. Yep. Diane. Diane, I like that necklace. It's got is that an angel? Yes. Did you dress yourself? You changed it the last minute. Was it because you wanted to look impressive? You were going to this hot social gathering? I like it because, you know, sometimes I think we rush out and we don't make the choice that makes us feel comfortable and good about ourselves. But by taking that moment of going, you know what? I'm going to switch it up because I'm not comfortable in this. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to grab my angel necklace. And then I'm going to go out on the town and people are going to notice. And you know what? They did, didn't they, Diane? You look great. I'm proud of you. So here's a fun fact about me. I took one of those ancestry DNA tests, and it turns out I am 100% part of the problem. like a lot of my generation is. Generation X was a very complacent generation. We didn't necessarily do a lot to make things worse, but we didn't do much to make them better either. We mostly just stood around, had an edible, came to a comedy show. I'll tell you who I'm proud of is this younger generation. These Generation Z kids and the younger of the millennial generation, they are going to make the world a better place. I truly believe that. Yeah, absolutely. Like this younger generation, they're working to do things like call out and dismantle systemic oppression of all kinds. That's amazing. My generation couldn't even dismantle Limp Bizkit. That band's still together. They're touring again. That's on us. We owe you an apology. This younger generation, they're doing the work. You know, they're like changing the conversation around mental health, making it okay to go to therapy. My generation wasn't about to go to therapy. Yeah, we didn't talk about our feelings. We were repressed. Instead of going to therapy, my generation invented mosh pits. We were like, we will deal with our emotions in our own way. By going to a concert, getting into a giant crowd of strangers, and fight dancing. By the way, fight dancing is not the same thing as dance fighting. Don't confuse the two. Fight dancing is what you do in a mosh pit. Dance fighting is what you do in a West Side Story. Something I don't really like very much about my generation, and I think this happens to a lot of generations as they get older, we tend to be very unsupportive of anything that is different than it was when we were growing up. And we gotta be better about that. Now, just because something is new or different or you don't understand it doesn't mean that there's something wrong with it. Now, I think that's something that this younger generation is doing really well. They're making it okay to be you. No matter how weird or unique you are, like, it's accepted. Not just that, it's, like, celebrated. There's no shame. I love that. Well, I think you can tell a lot about society by the way people treat things that they don't like, but that also don't really affect them in any way. For example, pineapple on pizza. Some people like pineapple on pizza. People are divided, though, on the topic, right? Some people like pineapple on pizza. Some people don't. But I have also noticed some people not only don't like to have pineapple on their pizza, they don't want anyone else to have pineapple on their pizza. Even if those people like it. Yeah, they hate the very idea of pineapple on pizza so much that they'll ruin the enjoyment of others, even though it doesn't hurt or affect them in any way. These people would prefer that it were illegal to put pineapple on pizza. They want it banished from menus nationwide. I've got an uncle in this camp. He's one of these pineophobes. He thinks he's a free thinker, but he's not a free thinker. Every family's got one. He'll tell you he doesn't mind if you have pineapple on your pizza. He just doesn't want to see it out in public. He would prefer you take your pineapple behind closed doors and not throw it in his face. Some of these pineophobes are parents. They were against pineapple on pizza in schools. They refer to it as the pineapple agenda. They're worried that if their kids see another kid having pineapple on their pizza, they're gonna realize it's an option. They're gonna wanna try a little pineapple on their own pizza. Next thing you know, the kids are up in their room with the door locked, downloading the Domino's app. I've tried pineapple on pizza. I experimented in college. I liked it too. There for a while, it was all that I ate. But then when I would go home in between semesters, I was worried that my parents wouldn't understand, so I'd stick with mushroom. So I was scared. But I like to think that if I were a parent now, that my kid could come home and know that no matter what they like on their pizza, their father's gonna love and accept them. They don't have to hide it, they can eat it right in front of me. Because all pizza is food, and no one should go hungry just because their menu's a little different than mine. Now, I know that makes it sound like maybe I would be a good dad. I'm not so sure that's true. Allow me to make my case. I got a lot of friends that have kids, and like they'll bring their kids around to gatherings, like, you know, picnics, barbecues, And when I interact with their kids, I'm good with children. Kids like me. And my friends will see that and they'll say, Jamie, you are great with kids. You should consider being a parent. You'd be a great dad. But just because kids like you does not mean you'd be a good parent. Kids like things that are terrible for them. Kids like me because I'm immature and irresponsible. That makes me fun. But when you're a parent, you're in charge of the safety and the well-being of the children. Your number one job is to keep those kids alive. And I'm not so sure I could do that. This afternoon I was watching TV. I lost the remote control 3 times during a 20-minute time span. One of those times I was sitting on it. You give me a baby, I can't guarantee the same thing won't happen. You have to give life advice to your kids? Like, I have knowledge to pass on, sure. But I don't think I have the kind of advice that kids could take with them as they enter the world and try to become contributing members of society. I don't know what kind of advice I give. Like, if you're going to commit a crime, do it before you're 18. You won't do real jail time. You have to deal with issues like teenage drinking. I don't know what I'd do if I caught my teenager drinking. I think I'd just be like, oh, you like to drink, do you? Me too. High five. No, you are in trouble, though. You are. So you got to be punished. So your punishment is... tonight you're going to get blackout drunk with your old man while I teach you about the history of WrestleMania. But heart disease and man boobs do run in the family. We're drinking Michelob Ultra. You got to learn about empty calories. You have to have the sex talk with your kids? I don't want to have to explain sex to my children. I have no idea how to begin that conversation. Sit down, Junior. We got to have a talk. You know that part of your body you pee out of? You are not going to believe what your mom lets me do with mine. Here are some pictures. Don't worry, I blurred out our faces. Where are you going? Sit back down. We still got to go over the 3 C's. That's condoms, consent, and cornucopia. Cornucopia is your mother's safe word. I think the part about being a parent that I would look forward to the least would be disciplining your children. But that's inevitable, right? There have to be rules. And when the rules are broken, there have to be consequences. Otherwise, they're not rules. They're just suggestions. I don't think I could spank my kids. And like, I'll hear adults now and then, they'll say, like, I was spanked when I was a kid and I turned out fine. You ever notice the people who say that, they never say it in a calm and relaxed manner? It's always, I was spanked and I turned out fine! Did you, Greg? Here's how old I am. When I was in elementary school, the teachers were allowed to spank the students. These days, when kids get in trouble, they get time out or a note sent home to their parents. If it's a Montessori school, I think they just get away with it. But at Jefferson Elementary in the mid-80s, you got the paddle. The paddle was a big fat slab of wood with a handle on the end. It stood as a symbol of everything that was at stake when you broke the rules in my school. Most kids never even saw the paddle. They just heard it. It was legendary. And in the first grade, it was my greatest fear. The person who wielded the paddle was my teacher, Mrs. Kennedy. She was a stern, white-haired older lady with nicotine-stained teeth and the baggy eyes of someone who's been exhausted by a system that expects too much. She was like Danny Glover in Lethal Weapon. Retirement was right around the corner, and she was just hanging on to collect that pension she'd walked through hell for. If you broke a big rule in my school, you would get the paddle. Smaller rules might get your name written on the chalkboard. Perhaps you'd miss recess. But if you broke a biggie, Mrs. Kennedy would take you out of the classroom, down the hall, around the corner, to the janitor's closet, where the paddle was kept on a high shelf above mop buckets, cleaning solutions, and this grimy sink that smelled somehow both clean and dirty at the same time. The janitor's closet was on the opposite side of the wall of our first grade classroom. So anytime Mrs. Kennedy would take a kid out to get paddled, as soon as they would leave the classroom, all the students would get up out of our desks, walk over to the wall, and place our ear against it, and listen for the thwack of the paddle to come down. Then we'd sprint back to our desks, giggling and laughing and waiting for the door to open and Mrs. Kennedy to escort the crying culprit back to their seat. Yeah, around Halloween that year, I got to take a trip to the janitor's closet. To celebrate the holiday, Mrs. Kennedy had spent her own money, proving she hadn't given up entirely, on these little pumpkin-shaped erasers. She handed them out to all the kids in class. They were tiny and orange and shaped like a pumpkin. They'd fit on the end of your pencil so that your writing utensil was topped with a fun, festive little Halloween decoration. I was a poor kid. My family was on welfare. Most of my toys were hand-me-downs from my uncles. So even like a small gift like a pumpkin eraser meant a lot to me. The kid that sat next to me in class, his name was Joey. He had blonde hair that jutted out in every direction. He looked like Pigpen from the Peanuts cartoons. This is before we knew anything about ADD, but I can guarantee you, Joey had ADD. This particular afternoon, we were left, all the students, completely unsupervised in the classroom. Like, that's a thing that teachers just used to be able to do, just leave the students completely unattended. But back then, you could just be like, all right, kids, get out your crayons. Here's a picture of a jack-o'-lantern, and I'm going to swing by the teacher's lounge for a smoke and a martini. So I'm sitting there with the other students. We're all, you know, left to our own devices. And I notice Joey sitting next to me. He's just kind of staring off in a daze, just zoning out completely. There's a little puddle of drool forming on the desk below his chin. And he's got his pumpkin eraser in his hand, and he's just absentmindedly ripping it into tiny little pieces. He doesn't even realize that he's doing it. So I whisper to him, Joey, what are you doing? You ruined your pumpkin eraser. He snaps out of it, looks down, realizes what he's done. And this entitled little jerk decides to help himself to my pumpkin eraser. My pencil was just sitting on the corner of my desk. Joey grabs the pencil, pops the eraser off it, puts it on his pencil right in front of my face. I may just be 6 years old, but I know the code of the streets. If you let somebody take what is yours, they'll be doing that for the rest of your life. Well, six-year-old Jamie was no doormat. I reached out to take my eraser back. Joey didn't want to give it back, so we're both grasping for this thing. It flies across the room. Joey slides on his stomach along the floor after it. I get up, I jump on Joey. We're wrestling in the middle of the room. All the other students form a circle around us. They're screaming and shrieking, having a great time. Until all of a sudden, everybody goes quiet. The door opens. It's Mrs. Kennedy. She's back. And she wants to know what's going on. So I looked up at her and I said, Joey stole my pumpkin eraser. Certain that my lawyering skills would get me off the hook. And she just looked down at me and said, well, why didn't you just wait until I got back and tell me? I have extra erasers, you know. No, Mrs. Kennedy, I did not know. I didn't realize you were a millionaire. It didn't matter who started it. She sat me down at my desk and said, you wait right here. I will deal with you next. And then she walked the green mile with Joey. He was a dead man walking straight to that janitor's closet. And after they left the classroom, I got up with everybody else, walked over to the wall, placed my ear against it. We heard the paddle come down. Joey screamed. They laughed. I gasped. Because I knew I was next. The paddle wasn't just about pain. It was about shame. It was about humiliation. And I wanted no part of it. So on my way to the janitor's closet, I came up with a plan. I'd remembered a time earlier in the year. I'd been spending the night at a friend's house. And my friend's mom threatened to spank me when I refused to eat her weird macaroni salad. It had raisins. What are you going to do? I told my mom what happened, and she gave me some choice words I should tell that lady if she ever threatened me again. And I remembered them as I entered that janitor's closet. So dark, so ominous. Just me and my fully grown adult teacher alone together in a closet as she told me to bend over. How is this a thing that used to be okay? Well, as she reached on that high shelf for the paddle, I looked up at her and I said, Mrs. Kennedy, my mother told me that if you touch me with that thing, she will sue you for every penny you've got. Here's the thing, that was a total bluff. All right, we were not about to sue. We were on welfare. My mom didn't even know a lawyer, except for maybe a court-appointed one. But Mrs. Kennedy didn't have the energy for that kind of a fight left in her. She sighed audibly, her shoulders slumped. And just to save face, she said, well, Jamie, I'll be giving your mother a call tonight. We will revisit this tomorrow. But there was no phone call. I mean, if a kid has both the knowledge and the audacity to say something like that to an adult, do you even want to deal with the parents who taught them to speak those words to begin with? No. It was not worth the hassle. So a minute later, I returned to the classroom, and the laughter of my fellow students quickly turned to shocked silence when they realized my cheeks were completely dry. I was the first kid in the history of that first grade class to return from the janitor's closet without tears streaming down my face. I was an instant legend. And on my way back to the seat, I noticed something on the ground, and I bent down and picked up my pumpkin eraser. So yeah, I'm not into spanking. Not as a punishment, at least, as a reward, well. Plus, I don't think, like, as a father, I should even be allowed to punish my kids. I'm already having sex with their mom. That's punishment enough. To be clear, it's not punishment for me. I enjoy it. But when you're a kid and you first realize sex is something that your parents do, it's mortifying. It's like the worst possible thing that you can imagine. I actually think maybe we're missing out on an opportunity. Maybe that's how we should be punishing our kids. Follow me here. I think it would be more effective than any of the other stuff we're doing. All right, you know, you break the rules. There's no spanking. There's no timeout. You do something wrong, I do your mom. I think it would be effective. Look at your bedroom. This place is a mess. That's the third time this week I told you to clean this room up. You leave me no choice. I'm gonna have to have sex with your mom. Look at this report card. This is terrible. You promised to bring your Spanish grade up. This is a D. Speaking of D. Honey, get upstairs. It's the only way these kids are ever gonna learn. I have a dog. That's a weird transition, isn't it? I do. I have a dog. Do we have any pet people in the house? Yes. So my dog's name is Henry. He's my little buddy. He's a little cocker spaniel, and he was actually my wife's before we met. She got him when he was a puppy. And when we first started dating, when I got Henry's approval, I was in, baby. You pass the dog test, you're golden. So that's our family now. It's her, me, and Henry the dog. He's on Prozac. Yeah, he visits a behaviorist, which is like a therapist for dogs. And according to his therapist, he's battling depression. I was resistant to that diagnosis. I was like, first off, how can you even tell? There's no way he's depressed. He doesn't have a job. No bills to pay. There's food in his bowl. He spends half the day sitting around licking his own penis. What does he have to be depressed about? And then I thought about it for a second. I realized maybe he does have some reasons to be depressed. He is under a lot of pressure, you know, to be a good boy. He never met his father. That's a weird thing to laugh at. You guys are cold-blooded. He was taken away from his mom and his siblings at a very young age. And at some point, we took him to the doctor where he was drugged, and when he woke up, his testicles were gone. I'd be depressed, too. I mentioned my dog because there are a lot of people who don't have children, but they have pets. And they like to say their pets are their kids. Wrong answer. I'm not buying it. I know you love your pets. I will even go so far as to say that your pets are part of your family. Absolutely. But they're not your kids. Being a pet owner does not make you a parent. If it did, then at some point you would release your pets into the wild. Hoping that you taught them all they need to know to make it in this world. Maybe you get a phone call now and then. You'd see them on holidays. Thanksgiving, Christmas, they'd be homeward bound. And you'd ask them, when are you going to give me grandpets? And they'd say, never, you neutered me, remember? So I don't think I'm ever going to be a dad. And like, that feels weird to say that out loud and, you know, like, admit it with finality. Because society puts all this emphasis on the idea of, like, the family line, of giving a kid your last name and having them carry on your legacy long after you're dead. Women have it worse. These days, like, I feel like we're going backwards in terms of women's rights. And when a woman says that she doesn't want to be a mother, people look at her like she's committing a crime against nature. There are 8 billion people on planet Earth. 8 billion. We're not getting low on humans. We're not going to run out. When a woman says she doesn't want to have kids, don't give her an attitude. Give her a high five. Yeah. We got to start listening to women. And like, we're not collectively, as a society, we've not been listening to women. Because they've been telling us what they want for years. And we still haven't given it to them. None of it's unreasonable. I'll tell you what women want. Well, I mean, other than respect, equal wages, and body autonomy. Women want pockets. Am I wrong? Ladies, would you like more pockets? Yeah. For years, women have been begging us for more pockets. We have not delivered. Women love pockets. When a woman does get pockets, she is thrilled. Put pockets on a dress, you got a happy lady. Now, compliment her on that dress. Say, hey, I like your dress. You know what she'll say? Thanks, it's got pockets. Yeah. Ladies have to store things in their bras because we're not giving them enough pockets. Every time a woman sees a guy in cargo shorts, that's got to feel like a slap in the face. I got a freezer full of Hot Pockets. My freezer has more pockets than my wife's closet. That's not fair. I got off on a little bit of a tangent there. I was talking about how I'm not going to be a father. I'm never going to be a dad. And that means there are a lot of things that I'll never get to do. You know, like, I'll never get to embarrass my kids. I feel like I would have been good at that. You know? Never get to change their diapers. I guess that's not a great loss. But I'll never get to, like, watch them take their first steps or put a Band-Aid on their boo-boo when they skin their knee or read them a story when I'm tucking them into bed at night or check under that bed to make sure there's no monsters. I'll never get to play Santa Claus and watch their little eyes light up on Christmas morning, cheer them on at their high school graduation and send them into the world praying that I didn't raise a serial killer. Send them money while they're in college, knowing full well they're going to blow it all on booze. Teach them how to drive a stick shift. Or attend their dance recital and lie to their face about how good it was. I'll never open a Father's Day card and see their little name scrawled below a note that was clearly written by their mother. I never learned how to roll a joint. I say that for a reason. And by the way, I don't really smoke marijuana these days, but when I was younger, I did my share of the old puff, puff, pass. But I never learned how to roll a joint, and I never wanted to because, well, I guess I was sort of saving it as a bonding experience to have with my teenage kid. In my parenting fantasy, my teenager would come home and burst into their bedroom and be surprised to find me sitting on the edge of their bed with a very serious look on my face. Hey, Dad, they would say. Don't hey, Dad, me, I'd say. You have something you'd like to tell me? And they'd get all nervous, but they wouldn't say anything because teenagers do a lot of things that might get them in trouble, and they don't want to accidentally admit to something that I don't already know about. And that's when I would hold up a bag of marijuana cigarettes that I found in their sock drawer. And I'd say, you want to tell me about these? And they'd be like, Dad, those aren't mine. I was holding them for a friend. And I'd say, don't give me that cockamamie story. By the way, cockamamie is not a word that I currently use. But as a dad, it would be part of my daily vocabulary. Don't give me that cockamamie story. This will all go a lot easier if you just tell me the truth. And they'd say, fine, okay, they're mine, but it's no big deal. It's just weed. Just weed, I'd say. Yeah, just weed. It's legal in most states now. Not for teenagers, it isn't. And I'm going to ask you a question, and don't you lie to me. These joints right here, did you roll them yourself? And they'd look down at the ground. Answer me, I'd say. Yeah. And then I'd put my arm around their shoulders. And I'd say, could you teach me how to roll one? And they'd be like, what? And I'd be like, yeah, your dad is cool. Now teach me how to roll a joint. And they would, and we'd bond as I learned how to roll a joint. And I would hold up the first joint I ever rolled, and I'd say, you want to spark a dube with your old man? And as I passed that dube to my teenage kid, I would say, don't tell your mother. Because she will have a conniption fit. By the way, only parents get to have conniption fits. So that's another thing I'll never get to do. I'll never get to just be there for them, no matter what, unconditionally. And what I guess I don't get to have, at least in the traditional sense, is this idea of a legacy, of someone who's next in line for me carrying on. My literal DNA is done. I don't get to send a person that I made into this world, and at the end of my life, I don't get to say, you'll carry on my legacy with your own kids. No one's ever going to visit my grave and say, Dad, I miss you. So I'll have to find other ways to make my mark, to leave my legacy. And I think I can do that. Instead of leaving my imprint, my ideals, lessons, and philosophy on a child, I get to make a ripple out into the world. And I figure if I'm kind to enough people and if I make enough people laugh, that at least some of them will pass that on to people that I've never even met. And somewhere down the line, years from now, maybe across the world, there'll be someone that's smiling. And you'd be able to trace that smile back to a laugh that started with me. And even though I'll never get to see them, those moments will be my legacy. I guess I have to take the time to pass the lessons that I've learned on to people who aren't my kids, the people who simply want to listen. So I think that's what we need to do the most right now is listen. When someone says that they're hurting, listen. We all need to start listening to each other and giving each other the chance to change. We got to stop arguing about stupid stuff, like whether or not a hot dog is a sandwich. It doesn't matter if a hot dog is a sandwich. It's a hot dog and it's delicious. That should be enough. Not everything has to fit into a category. And that goes, yeah, that's okay. That goes double for people. You know, people are messy. People are always changing. And not everyone is going to fit into the narrow set of boxes that we were told that they would. But people will tell you and they will show you who they are. I mean, the fact that I even have a microphone to stand in front of you and talk about how hard it is to come to grips with the fact that my straight, white, male, cisgender, middle-class self isn't going to be a daddy simply because he chose not to, that's ridiculous. That's privilege. And I know women have it tougher. People of color, those who are gay, transgender, impoverished, disabled, or a myriad of other situations or conditions, people are going to face things in life that I'll never fully know what it's like to experience. And here's the thing. Like, the fact is, it's not convenient for me to take all those people into account every time I make a joke. Hell, it's not possible for me to consider everyone that I may hurt every time I make a statement or when someone makes a video that goes viral or when our government makes a policy. But when we realize that it's happened, when those people speak out, shouldn't we listen? Yeah. We don't have to. That's the thing about America. We have the freedom to ignore. But we also have the freedom to listen and grow and lift each other up. And if we're not going to take the time to listen and then change based on what we've learned, then maybe we've missed the point of being human in the first place. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to try to do a better job of listening, because in the history of the world, no problem's ever been solved simply by ignoring it. But you don't have to listen to me. I'm not your dad. Being a husband's cool. I like it. I'm so lucky that I've got this amazing wife. She is just beautiful and kind and brilliant and so supportive. Like, not just emotionally. She brings home the bacon, y'all. She is the breadwinner, the bill payer. And she encourages me to keep doing things like this because she knows how important it is to me to try to bring joy to strangers. Real talk, this is kind of the only job that I know how to do. I've tried other lines of work. I've had other jobs, but none of them ever really worked out. One of the first jobs that I ever had, you may have guessed this just by looking at me. I was once the assistant manager at a Claire's boutique. It was the late 90s. I had frosted tips. I fit the profile. Before I worked at Claire's, I had another job in the mall. I worked at a place called Mr. Bulky. The bulk candy store where you can go from perfectly healthy to full-blown diabetes in a single purchase. One of the perks when you work at Mr. Bulky is all the free candy you can eat. With this metabolism and my lack of impulse control, I knew that was a death sentence. I had to get out of there. The thing about working in the mall, though, is if you don't like your job, just wait till your lunch break and go get another one. So that's what I did on my lunch break. I walked past the food court, said hello to Mrs. Fields. And I noticed a sign in the window at Claire's Boutique that said, now hiring. And I was like, dare I? Well, I did dare. I went in, I applied, and I got the job. And like I said, this is the late 90s, so Hanson and the Spice Girls were really popular. We sold a lot of their merch. I remember we sold a Spice Girls lunchbox, and in pink letters across the front, it said, spice up your lunch. So we also sold a Hanson lollipop. You're not going to believe what it's called. It's called an M-pop. It was a hot seller. I sure like sucking on mine. Part of the job when you work at Claire's Boutique is piercing people's ears. Yeah, putting holes in the bodies of humans. For $7 an hour. Because, you know, when you're getting your flesh punctured, the place you want to go is sandwiched in between an Orange Julius and a Spencer's Gifts. You would think that a job like that would include some extensive safety and sanitary training. It did not. They gave me a pamphlet, which I studied for about a half an hour. Then I took a quick multiple choice test, which I did cheat on. Practiced one time on a piece of cardboard and then got my ass in the game. And people would bring in their newborn babies to get pierced. Yeah, that's the correct response. They would come in and be like, I just had this baby. I want you to put a hole in my baby. And I would be like, I am qualified to do that. Set that little sucker down. And I learned this the hard way. When you're piercing a baby's ears, you want to do it with a partner. Because if you do it by yourself, you have to do one ear and then the other ear. You will not be getting to the other ear. You do the first ear, the baby throws a fit. That's all she wrote. But babies are tricky. They'll fool you. Because right after you pierce that first ear, there's about a second and a half of silence. Just enough time for a little hope to creep into your heart. For you to think to yourself, oh, thank God, this one's not going to cry. But what's happening during that second and a half of silence is that baby is breathing in the biggest breath on planet Earth. and preparing to unleash hell upon them all. So you learn from your lesson. You get with a partner and you're like, we're each on one ear, right? Yep. Okay, we're going on three? On three. One, two, three. Holding a baby. Parents hate it when you shout that out loud. You may have also guessed this. I have been fired from a Claire's boutique. But things are good now. I'm really lucky to have such a supportive spouse. She realizes that, you know, my career may never be lucrative. Heck, during the lockdown part of the pandemic, it was pretty much non-existent, and it might not ever get back to full force. But that's okay. My baby takes care of me. That's right. I knew that she was the one right after our first date. I mean, immediately. She says she did too, which is wild to me, because on paper, I was not exactly what they would call a keeper. I was a nearly 40-year-old man who didn't even own a bed. I slept on an exercise mat. My automobile was a bicycle. And I lived in an apartment with a bullet hole in the wall from a previous tenant who I'm assuming either didn't get his deposit back or definitely got his deposit back. And I had a Cricket phone that would get shut off every month because I could never afford to pay the bill on time. But somehow she saw through the grit and the grime and the red flags that I was waving with both hands. And I won her heart. 3 months later, I moved in. 3 years later, I'd managed to save up enough to buy her a ring. And now we're married. Yeah. And if we're being honest, comedy is not paying the mortgage. But that's okay, you know. I am what is known as a kept man. A stay-at-home spouse. I make contributions to our relationship that are non-monetary, and it works for us. I'm living the kind of American dream that can only exist when you refuse to buy into the traditional relationship-based gender roles that society tries to force upon you. What I am...
What are you, bro?
Well, you know what I am.
What is that? What is that?
I'm a house husband.
A house husband? What?
Girl, this one's for you. Girl, you know that I want to do all those nasty things that you want me to. Like, wash the dishes, scrub the floor. Come on, baby, won't your name mature?
Come on.
Cut the grass, trim your trees.
Let's go.
You won't even have to say pretty please. I'll dust, sweep, girl, I'll even mop. Give me the grocery list. I'll go and shop. I'll have dinner waiting when you get home, but if you're gonna be late, girl, you better phone. I wanna fulfill your each and every need. I'm your house husband. We're a progressive breed.
I'm your house husband.
Let's go.
I'll mow the lawn.
I'm your house husband.
Cut grease with Dawn.
I'm your house husband.
My love's been tried and tested.
Let's go.
I'm your house husband.
I'm your house husband, girl.
Baby, I'm so domestic.
Woo! Yeah, get up. Come on, come on, come on. Yeah, yeah.
Girl, you know I want to help your career. You're like a Wall Street athlete. It's my job to cheer, working out, eating right to look good for you. Thanks to your insurance, got a teeth whitening too. When the weekend comes, I'm rubbing your feet. I put steaks on the grill. I deliver the meat.
Okay.
Make the bed in the morning, tuck you in at night, and be the first to apologize whenever we fight.
I'm your house husband.
I'm your number one fan.
I'm your house husband.
Let's go.
Fry it up in a pan.
I'm your house husband. I'm your house husband, girl.
And our union is blessed.
I'm your house husband.
Baby, I'm so domestic. The older we get,
the older we get,
the less that we'll be apart. I'll take a pill for my erection, and then a pill for my heart.
The Adra, baby.
You're still the apple of my eye. Although I've got cataracts, we'll see the chiropractor, and he'll straighten our backs. We've been through stormy weather. You know it's only getting better.
Every day.
I'm glad that we can sit and watch the sun set together.
Getting real low.
I'll make lemonade. We'll reminisce on the porch. You'll say we're out of depends. And I'll run right to the store. Run yo.
House husband.
Yeah, yeah.
Till death do us part. I'm your
house husband.
You still love me when I fart.
I'm your house husband.
Woo! You let me see you bare-breasted.
I'm your house husband.
Baby, I'm so domestic.
Let's go.
Holy crap, Kansas City, we sold this place out. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Oh my gosh. I cannot thank you enough. My heart is so full tonight.